This week, Conflict Zone is in Vienna to talk to Austrian Foreign Minister Karin Kneissl. She was nominated for the post by the anti-immigration and right-wing party FPO, although she is not a member of the party. But do the FPO's policies match her views? And how does all this affect Austria's place in Europe? Karin Kneissl, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Thank you very much, sir.
Let's start with Austria's relationship with Russia. President Vladimir Putin is a close ally of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, a mass murderer of his own people. Both have hundreds of thousands of civilian lives on their conscience. How do you judge Putin's role in this inferno?
When Russia started to intervene in Syria, that was the official date was 30th of September 2015. The Islamic State, as it had named itself then, was proceeding towards Latakia. And I remember very well Special Envoy of the United Nations, Staffan de Mistura, warning against a mass exodus from Latakia if the IS would start massacring Latakia.
So now Assad is replacing the mass murdering of the IS with the support of Russia. We are now 2018, and we were aware and we saw what happens in Syria with the full support of Russia.
So my question is again, how do you judge today?
Putin's role in this inferno.
What we have not only Mr. Putin and Mr. Assad in Syria, we have a proxy war that started in summer 2011 with a number of stakeholders, and Russia is one of those.
Yeah, but a very important one. Mr. Assad couldn't continue his mass murdering without Mr. Putin. Perhaps Iran is also necessary, but we are now in Europe, and Putin is a very important player. So again, how do you judge Putin's role in this inferno?
I see Russia as a partner in Syria. And we have said that several times. We have said that, and it's not only me, it's the European Union that has stated that. And during our last EU Council meeting here in Vienna, at the Gymnich 2 weeks ago, we said we have to take a pragmatic approach in terms of working together with Russia
and Syria. I know that other leaders in Europe and in the world, also in Europe, are condemning Mr. Putin's role. So
yes,
what is the position of the foreign minister in Austria?
The position, and that is not only my position, we have discussed it at various instances, also inside the European Union, that we have to work with Russia in Syria.
But I understand your pragmatic argumentation. But behind such an argumentation, it is very important to understand your values. So, firstly, I think there has to be a judgment. Do you condemn it or not? And after this, then a discussion can happen. Do you condemn Mr. Putin's role in the Middle East and especially in Syria? Yes or no?
I am not here about condemning.
You are not?
I'm not condemning
him. Hundreds and thousands of civilians are dying.
They were killed by various actors in
also,
the Middle East.
Also Russia?
Also Russia, yes.
So this is not sufficient to condemn Russia?
We have condemned whatever has happened in Syria at various instances.
Why are you so shy if it
I'm
is
not
going
at
on
all shy.
About Mr. Putin? I mean, you invited Russian President Putin to your wedding last month, and he came. Why did you invite him? Is he a friend of yours?
It was a spontaneous act. I had met him beforehand. We had had a long exchange of ideas of how we see certain things, also in the Middle East. And he had an interest in my analysis. And when he
and that's why he's coming to your wedding, to continue to have an analysis about international problems during your wedding?
We also discussed Syria. Yes.
So it was not a private meeting?
It was a private meeting.
With discussions about Syria?
We also had a very brief encounter, yes, on Syria.
Why didn't you invite Merkel or Monsieur Macron?
I invited Jeremy Hunt, he had no time.
You were dancing and hugging Mr. Putin, and while you did that, you knew that he is a partner of Syrian dictator Assad. Both have blood on their hands. You didn't have a guilty conscience
to dance
with such a man who is also suppressing his own population?
Yes, but excuse me. Then in that case, shall we shake hands with the Chinese government? Shall we shake hands with a number of governments, you see.
Don't you think there's a difference between shaking hands and dancing and hugging on one of the most important private days in your life?
Hugging, I understand in a different way than you might understand it. I didn't hug him. We danced, yes, and I've danced with several men in my life before.
Is that a wrong symbol? I mean, it is your wedding. What is the symbol, for example, for people who are suppressed in Russia? It was a private evening.
Yes,
there is a difference, and that's why I understand you have to dialogize, you have to meet even with dictators.
Yes.
But it is your wedding, and you danced with him?
I danced with him, exactly, yes.
Vladimir Putin, Russia, is also under EU sanctions because he annexed Crimea and Ukraine.
Yes, and we have condemned that, and we keep our sanctions in force on that.
Austria had a lot of diplomatic trouble after Putin's so-called private visit. During Chancellor Sebastian Kurz's visit to Ukraine, the foreign minister, Pavlo, your colleague, Klimpim, described this invitation as a serious mistake. Do you agree?
No.
Why not?
Because I invited him and I don't regret it. And there was this one message conveyed by in a private meeting that Pavel Klimpim had. But otherwise, I may only inform you that none of my colleagues, whom I had welcomed here 10 days after my wedding, was discussing that.
But perhaps so this is diplomacy.
No.
But you're also very diplomatic.
Yes, but you can, if you don't like certain things, you can say it.
You don't necessarily have to.
Well, on the contrary, I got congratulations and from all my colleagues.
About what, dancing with Mr. Putin?
I don't know what to congratulate.
Perhaps because you had a wedding.
Imagine that, yes.
The EU adapted sanctions against Russia. The FPO supported the annexation and is against sanctions. Do you back the FPO position?
We are part of a government.
And who is now we?
We, the government. I'm speaking here in my capacity as member of the Austrian government. And we, the Austrian government, have based our coalition contract on keeping in tandem with the European Union whatever regards the sanction regime.
So you agree with the sanction?
Yes, of course. Have I ever said anything else?
The party which nominated you for the post of foreign minister, the extreme right-wing nationalist and anti-immigration FPO, has a 5-year cooperation agreement with Putin's United Russia Party. Do you, as foreign minister, approve of doing deals with a party that helps sustain autocratic system?
I don't comment what parties do, I don't comment what deputies
but
do.
But they nominated you are not a neutral person.
No, but they nominated, yes. And since you also studied in France, I'm a follower of Montesquieu when it comes to separation of powers. And what deputies do, it's up to the deputies to control me. It's not up to me to tell the deputies what to do.
It's up to you to have an opinion in such an international issue.
Yes,
so
and
I'm asking
have,
you for
I'm
your
not
opinion.
Commenting. And I am not commenting it.
You don't?
No, I don't comment it, sir.
Interesting that you're so shy to give a comment about a party
which is a party member of your coalition.
But
I'm certainly not shy. Only that I like to speak
about... You were not
about
so shy if it was about Mr. Putin. You are more shy about
the FPO? I'm not shy on all that. I like to speak about things which I have in my operative hands.
Let's look at migration. In Germany, a compromise was stuck between Angela Merkel's CDU and the Bavarian CSU on sending migrants back at the border, also to Austria, as it happens. Good idea?
This idea was not discussed with the Austrian government beforehand, and afterwards we had a series of talks, and right now the Council of Ministers of Interior is once again trying to handle that in such a way that we are not stuck with quotas, we are not stuck with refoulement at the border, but that we try to reinvent the entire system in a way that is adapt for the situation
this
that
is the
we
theory.
Have.
The practice is very the practice
yeah, but,
is clear.
But the practice is
I was at the border and they are rejecting. Germany is rejecting to Austria. The Austrian government has criticized, as you mentioned, the deal and promised to take measures to protect Austria and its people. How exactly?
Well, what you're talking about are the news from early June. We are now in a different
stage. So what's the difference?
The difference is that actually the German government has not implemented what they had announced.
You have spoken of Austria taking in refugees after the Second World War from Czechoslovakia and Hungary. Quote, buses full of the elderly, you said, the sick and children, quote, not men with pent-up testosterone. What do you want to tell the world as a foreign minister by focusing on migrants with pent-up testosterone?
Can you please, I never said pent-up testosterone.
You said the sick and children. This was after World War II, and now not men with pent-up testosterone.
I never said that, sorry. I said that we have, I said in October 2015, I wrote an essay for an Austrian daily called Die Presse based on my book, which I offered you beforehand. And in my book, you can go through the annotation list, you will find all the sources on problems related to young men who are trying to create a status. And it's a fact that in most times of crisis, it's women and vulnerable who are among the refugees, because most of the time you have the men staying behind fighting. That was the case in Bosnia, that was the case in World War I and II. Now we have a different situation. Around 80% of those who arrived in 2015, 2016 are young men in the age of 18 to 30. And that this can create problem, I think that has
But a man between 18 and 30, let's say Austrian man, he is less pent up with testosterone. Why did you use this metaphor in relationship to migration?
But you take one phrase out of a larger context, and here
But
I may
you
disagree.
Just explained yeah, that what is behind this.
Yes, but what is behind that? You take one phrase and you don't continue the entire thought. The problem is, regardless, and I said that in my book and I said that in that very essay, that regardless of the cultural, ethnic, or religious background, regardless of that, at all instances in history, you had young men, when they are unable to create for themselves a status, that violence can follow. We had that in the Middle Ages, we had it, the Crusades were one way of channeling out testosterone, and that you can also read in scripts of the Catholic
Church. It's very interesting
to
use such a biological argumentation in relationship with migration, but you said also that those refugees, quote, are not people from next door, people who share our culture. Is this a valid reason to refuse to help refugees to survive in the Mediterranean and to send them back, that they don't share, as you think, our culture?
It is definitely a problem when you go into Iran, for instance, and I've been in Iran over the last 20 years on a regular level. Young men from Afghanistan who were brought up in Iran were more problematic than refugees
I wanted
they had
to,
from other cultures.
Bring
it was
in.
A different issue when we took, for instance, refugees in 1980 from Poland. It was a different issue with refugees from Hungary in 1956. And it is a fact that when you come, and I've been teaching in some of these courses, and I myself have been translating for the first half of 2015.
Would you say that intellectuals who are coming from Syria or wherever are not
sharing
our very culture?
I saw very few intellectuals. I met, and I was translating for about 8 months, and I met very few intellectuals. There were maybe 5%.
So you met normal people. Does it mean that they don't have our culture? And
Sorry, may I not answer
yes,
the phrase?
Don't
I mean, you're all the time interrupting, sir. I would just conclude my phrase now, yeah? Because you dominate the whole thing. It's your position. It's your character.
No, you can say
Fine.
Whatever you want.
So then I would be really delighted if I could have just 3 minutes to develop.
Three minutes
thoughts.
Is a
Perfect.
Lot.
Thank you very
we
much.
We are here in an interview.
Yes, and I've done many interviews in my life. But
me too.
Great. So then we are both professionals. And first, number one is that most of the young men I had been translating for were not the urban citizen of Syria, because the urban citizen of Syria had left Syria already in the 1980s because of the political situation that we have, or they had remained behind because they were trying
they
to...
They didn't migrate in the last 2-3 years?
There was a handful of them
a
who
handful,
had
migrated. Okay.
There was, but there was a very low percentage. Most of those who we currently have, for instance, in various assistance programs now, have a level of education which is basic. We do not have the high number of academics, and this is empirical evidence. Since in this ministry we are also in charge of integration, and we have seen the fact that about 55% of those who came since 25 are recipients of social assistance. They are not the medical doctors.
But you are aware of that international and EU asylum law and the Geneva Convention don't demand that refugees share the culture of the receiving countries. This is simply not the criterion.
Yes, but that doesn't mean we took the refugees. I just said it was a difference whether you take people from Hungary or whether you take people from Afghanistan. Austria took, after Sweden, the highest number of refugees per capita. There's no conflict in this argument.
Is it possible that we are talking about Islam? Ask if Islam belongs to Austria. You said Muslims, yes, Islam, no. What's the difference?
The difference is that Muslim citizens as individuals who have made their way in Austria, whether they came from Iran, whether they came from Algeria, they have adapted to Austria and they consider themselves first of all as Austrian citizens and secondly as Muslims. The other thing is...
But they're still Muslims.
Yes, and that's why I said Muslims, yes.
Islam is a part of their identity, as you just mentioned.
Yeah, but it's a different story whether you have Islam as a legal and normative concept that dominates everything and whether you consider yourself first as member of the
but
Ummah.
But in Austria, would you say that Islam is a part of your culture?
No.
I've learned a Christian is part of Austria, just as Christianity, correct? A Christian is part of Austria just as Christianity,
yes? In the meantime, we also had enlightenment, where we don't ask people, what is your religion?
So why do you ask if somebody is a Muslim?
I don't ask anybody.
Do you judge? I learned Judaism is part of your country. There were some years it was not so clear. Just as Jews are today a part of your country, Muslims, as you said, are part of your country, but not Islam.
Yes.
Why specifically this religion is taking out of your general
because
logic?
Because I believe in secular ideas and I don't ask anybody, what is the religion? I simply don't ask.
Don't you think that you are offending Muslims, Austrian Muslims, in saying that their religion is not a part in the country? You have 700,000 Austrian Muslims in your country.
Yes, and we have also thousands of them who consider themselves as liberals and who don't want to be suppressed by a normative system that they don't identify with.
So what's the argument?
The argument is the following, secular ideas. I don't ask anybody what is your religion. I'm simply interested what is your commitment to citizenship.
I have a last question about that. Look, 700,000 people, Austrian, are Muslims, 10% of your population, more or less. They are saying my identity is my nationality, my sexual point of views, my education and my religion. Who are you, being a representative of the state, to tell these Austrian peoples your religion is not a part of my country? Islam, no.
Because I only am interested in the individual and not in the larger concept of a normative system.
Let's talk about another subject. One of the most important pillars of the EU are democracy and the rule of law. Another country, Poland, is changing its judiciary. Most European member states see that as an attack on the rule of law and have led to the EU to launch legal proceedings against it. Do you agree with the move?
Well, my colleague from government, Mr. Blümel, is currently presiding these council meetings. So you better go and ask him about the details because he's the one who is in
What's
charge
the position
of this.
Of Austria?
Because we are in these council meetings presiding the interrogation. So it's not a matter of whether I agree on these things. It is that Austria, as an EU member state, as currently chair of the European Union, is presiding exactly these meetings. So
okay,
I don't understand your issue.
Do you?
No,
I'm sorry,
if we are not
it's
presiding?
My mistake.
Yes.
My question was not...
We are chairing these meetings right now.
My question
now, yeah?
was perhaps not clear.
Like many other questions.
Don't judge questions. I don't judge answers.
Yeah.
But
you do.
So I will be more precise. Do you think that what the Polish government and the Hungarian government are doing is a destructive way that democracy is decreasing in these countries? Do you believe that they are, for their own population and democracy, a bad example?
What the European
Poland and Hungary.
In the case of Hungary, in the case of Poland, it was a decision by the European Commission to start such an interrogation. The Polish government would be interested in a judgment by the European Court of Justice in order to have a clear-cut finding. And we are currently chairing the meetings in order to discuss how certain issues could be resolved in such a way that they comply with rule of law. This is the role of Austria in that meeting right now. And these meetings are chaired by my colleague who is in charge of EU affairs. It comes to Hungary,
yeah.
We had a, here it was not the European Commission, here it was the European Parliament. And inside the Parliament we have different factions. And there was a majority vote to also introduce such a procedure. And this procedure will most probably also be chaired by our colleagues in Brussels and therefore also by the Austrian government.
What is your point of view about Hungary's Prime Minister Orbán?
Prime Minister Orbán was elected several times, once in the 1990s, then again 8 or 10 years ago. And the way he is running his country or whatever, I am not commenting because I don't want to be commented by other colleagues. And I've said at various instances that these questions are questions I'm not interested in answering, because if you had asked me that question 10 months ago when I was just an analyst, just a commentator, yes, we could have commented it, but I'm not interested in commenting.
I can understand that you are not interested, but you can understand that we are interested,
yes,
to listen to,
and,
to the foreign minister of the country who is heading. You know, the question
is, at the same
is,
time, I'm not commenting,
do you believe
Mr.
That,
Trump, or I'm not.
Do you believe
Mr.
that
Macron?
In the EU, one country can decide to do whatever the country wants, and it's not also your cup of tea? I want to quote the report on which MEPs based their decision listed about Hungary, a dozen problem areas, including the independence of the judiciary, freedom of expression, right of migrants and refugees, corruption, the rights of minority, including Roma and Jews. And you don't think that a small comment is necessary? Everything is going on in Europe? This is the Europe you want to represent?
Yes, and
a democratic Europe with human rights, and you believe that Hungary is representing this too?
Sorry, but I'm not in charge of now deciding on who does what in Hungary. This is up to our common effort that we are currently undertaking in order to come back to certain procedures.
So I want to ask this question more generalized. Do you think that the European Union is under good conditions in regard to democracy, human rights, judiciary, rule of law?
The fact that we have a strong debate on rule of law, I think, is irritating, because as far as I remember, the moment you join the European Union, you have to comply with the so-called Copenhagen criteria that were developed in the 1990s. And here it was all about rule of law. We currently have inside the European Union various working groups. We have the topic of rule of law on council meetings. And this in itself, I would say, is an irritating development, because we are not speaking only about Hungary. You can start the same discussion on Bulgaria, on Romania, and on many other countries.
I agree. That's why a lot of countries are not representing the levels we discussed, that these would be the levels of Europe. But practically, as this show goes to air, you will welcoming EU foreign ministers in Salzburg. And one of the most important...
No, sorry, excuse me, sir, you're wrong informed. In Salzburg on the 20th of September, it will be the heads and states of government. The foreign ministers were here 10 days ago. I welcomed them. I will not be in
when
Salzburg.
I said you, I meant your government.
Yes, then okay.
You represent your government.
Yes.
I apologize.
I'm not in Salzburg, and it's not the foreign ministers.
That's, I didn't know that the foreign ministers
No,
are
the
not
foreign
with.
Ministers were already here,
okay.
As I mentioned.
We I
could
meant
have discussed
your government.
That in length, yeah.
What's Mr. about the Brexit?
Brexit, yes, we discussed that strongly. I had several foreign ministers of the United Kingdom here. I've established a very good working relation with Jeremy Hunt. And we have a lot of friction inside the European Union, but we do not have any friction when it comes to Brexit. There's a high degree of cohesion, and Michel Barnier got the mandate, according to the directives of March 2017, to negotiate on behalf of the EU27, and we support him here where we can.
Will the Brexit will be a cold Brexit?
We don't know yet. 80-90% of the withdrawal agreement are agreed upon. The remaining 10-20% deal with the question of Ireland, North Ireland, with the so-called backstop solution, who will take in customs control. And this, I myself, I will go to Ireland because I'm aware of the political dimension when it comes to the Irish on both sides of the borders.
Karin Kneissl, thank you for being on Conflict Zone. It was a pleasure. Thank you.